another peaceful day, and if anything in the office was going to wreck that peace, it was probably going to be somebody who forgot to fill the coffee pot, or someone took out their frustrations on a jammed copier with a couple of punches and kicks. That's what they expected. But on Tuesday, a shooter entered headquarters of YouTube in California and shot and injured 3 people. Instantly, these people's world of peace was shattered. And unfortunately, that pattern has become all too familiar for us in this world. But actually, this isn't a recent trend. This kind of thing has been happening throughout history. Last week, we were reminded of the events of Jesus' death. On Thursday night of the week that Jesus died, he and his disciples were enjoying a nice and peaceful Passover meal in the upstairs room of the house. Afterwards, they decided to go out and pray on a mountaintop. Nothing out of the ordinary. They had done this countless times. They expected that the peace of that evening would only be disturbed if they heard some rustling in the bushes from a bird or a little animal or something like that. But that was not the case. That night, the disciples and Jesus went out to pray it would be his last. The peace of that night was shattered by the sounds of a mob that had come to arrest Jesus. They arrested him, they put him on trial throughout the night. By morning, he was convicted of death and he was crucified. And by Friday night, he was dead and buried. You can imagine, after that, the disciples were pretty upset. The peace in their lives had been shattered and they were scared for their own lives. They were now in a city that had completely turned against their leader. And they were his closest followers. Who do you think was next on the list? Probably them. So we find them in our gospel reading from John chapter 20 that the disciples were behind locked doors because they were afraid that the Jews would find them and put them to death just like they had done to Jesus. And so while they were here, while they were hidden and scared, Jesus came and he stood among them. And this is what he said. Peace. Peace be with you. And after he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. And the people and the disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. They finally saw him back. It had been 3 days of fear and worry, but Jesus was back. He was there. They finally felt all of their nerves calm down and their blood pressure was going down as they stared at Jesus there alive in the flesh. But what does his appearance mean for you and me? Today we'll look at what it meant for the disciple that was not there that first Easter night. And we'll see the kind of peace that we have as people who have not seen Jesus. And the guarantee that we have, though, that we can live with peace in him. Thomas was that disciple that was not there that first Easter night. He was scared, like the other disciples. He was afraid that he would be put to death, but he didn't get that reassurance right away like the other disciples did. Later on, they told him, "Jesus is back. He appeared to us. We saw him." And there were many other accounts of that first Easter day. Jesus had appeared to a whole lot of people. Some of the people that Thomas was closest to, some of Jesus' closest followers. Thomas would not believe them. Thomas heard everything that they had to say, and he said, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands, and I put my finger where the nails were, and I put my hand into his side, I will not believe." Thomas rejected the peace that Jesus was hoping to bring the disciples. And it's understandable. It's hard for anybody to believe in something that they haven't seen, and it's really hard for us to believe in something that we aren't really sure is possible, like Jesus coming back from the dead. And we saw this play out in real life in our first lesson from Acts chapter 26. Paul was on trial before King Agrippa because this same attitude among the Jews that put Jesus to death was still around. The Jews were upset with Paul. He was trying to upset their balance. What they believed was the way that Scripture was supposed to be interpreted, not that Jesus would rise from the dead. And so they spread all these rumors that Paul was inciting riots, spreading a rumor that he was sharing this religion that went against the Roman Empire, that there was this risen Jesus and he was a king. This King Jesus was going to oppose Caesar as emperor. And the Jews were able to win over the local authorities, so Paul gets arrested and he has to appear before King Agrippa, who's king of that area in Israel. And as Paul stands there before him, he says, "I am not insane. What I'm saying is true and reasonable." All Paul was saying was that from Scripture, what had been written down centuries before had happened in Jesus, that he would live, die, and rise from the dead. And Paul further said, all of this happened out in the open. None of this was a secret. Paul says, King, you are familiar with everything that happened, and so I'm speaking freely to you. I'm convinced that none of this has escaped your notice because it was not done in a corner. All the events of what happened to Jesus happened right in downtown Jerusalem and on that hilltop outside. People know what happened. Paul says, King Agrippa, do you believe the prophets? I know you do. Paul appealed to this fact that King Agrippa knew everything that had happened, and he knew what the Scripture said. King Agrippa would not believe. And Thomas knew the Scriptures. He knew Jesus. He had seen the miracles that he had performed in his life. He had seen the kind of death that Jesus died. He had heard firsthand from Jesus' own followers, some of his best friends, but he would not believe unless he saw him. And so finally, a week later, the disciples were all together, and Thomas this time is with them. The doors were still locked, but Jesus came and stood among them. And again, Jesus says, "Peace be with you." And then he says, right to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out. Put it into my side. Stop doubting, Thomas, and believe." Jesus appeared to Thomas so that he would know for sure Jesus was back. He said, "Reach out, touch me, see, I'm real." And when Jesus appeared, Thomas said, "My Lord and my God." And Jesus said, "Because you've seen me, you believe." And then Jesus went on to say, "Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." It's not difficult for you and I to put ourselves in Thomas' sandals. You and I haven't seen Jesus face to face. His presence hasn't come to us and stood before us so that we can have peace in our lives. And so it's easy for us to fall into the same trap as Thomas did, to make these kinds of demands from God. "Jesus, I will not believe in you unless you appear to me." But we make those kinds of demands when we don't understand who Jesus is and what he promised to do for us. Jesus came to this world to save sinners. Sinners like you and I. And because we sin and we do bad things, our lives end in death. But because of God's great love for us, he sent Jesus to live a life without sin, so he could put that perfect life to death on the cross for us, to trade us that perfect life. So that now we die, and in God's eyes, we die without sin. So God will bring us back to life, and he says, "I have prepared a place for you to be with me in heaven. A place of peace. A place where you won't be affected by sin and all of the terrible consequences that follow." And Jesus' death on the cross paid for everybody's sins, whether they believe in him or not. Jesus died on the cross to make peace between us and God. But it was Thomas's lack of faith that tricked him into believing he had peace in his life with a dead Jesus. But there is no peace with a dead Savior. There's no peace in your life when someone you love dies. Death is horrible. Death is a separation between you and the people that you love, and it's a separation that we can't overcome on our own. We can't spend time with people that we've lost. We can't have conversations with them. We're cut off. It's gone. And the separation that the disciples experienced when they lost their Savior was huge. They dedicated their lives to following Jesus. They put all their hope and faith into this man as the one who was that promised Savior. And now he was gone. And they're living in that city with all these people who hate Jesus and probably hate them. So they spend day after day locked behind these closed doors, praying and hoping that no one comes and kills them. And so you and I can fall into that same kind of trap where we believe we have peace with a dead Jesus. It happens when we expect God to do things in our lives, and when we don't see him do those things in our lives, we assume he doesn't care about us, so he might as well be dead to us. It happens when we raise up our kids a certain way and they stop doing things how we raise them. And we pray to God and we hope that something happens in their lives where he changes them to come back. And when we don't see him do that, we start to lose faith in God. Or when we raised our kids to come to church, but they stop going, and maybe they even lose their relationship with God, and that hurts us. We expect God to do something about that. Or it happens when the government, when they start to make rules that don't seem to favor Christianity anymore. And we call out to God and go, God, save this country. But it seems like maybe it continues to go the other way. And maybe we worry that our whole country will collapse someday, and we wonder, God, do you even care? You said that you want to preserve us and keep us safe, but I don't feel safe anymore. Maybe you really don't feel safe after watching the news, and you think that going to work or going to school or going to any public place is going to result in you maybe being shot, maybe being taken out of this world early. Jesus has some words for us about that. In Matthew chapter 10, he says, "Do not be afraid of those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Rather, be afraid of the one who can destroy both soul and body in hell." What truly robs us of peace in this world are not the things that we can see, but the things that we cannot see. The things that rob us of peace in this world are what goes on in our hearts. True peace, then, is knowing what Jesus has done for us. And knowing what Jesus has done for us does not mean that we have to see him in person. Instead, Jesus gave us his words. Like he says from his disciple, from the apostle Peter. In 2 Peter chapter 1, we read that prophecy, what God said to people long ago, never had its origin in the will of man. It's what people thought was supposed to happen in the future. But prophets, though human, spoke from God, as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. See, the miracles of Jesus' life are the fact that before he came to this world, he told us exactly what he was going to do. He told that to men over centuries. And then long after he had told them that, he came and he accomplished all of those things, down to all the very details. And he accomplished promises and things that were all culminating to bring us peace, to save us from our sins, to save us from death and the hopelessness that we have in this world. And God is so gracious to us that he includes so many of the things that Jesus did. Really, all that we needed to know is that Jesus came to this world, lived a perfect life for us, died that perfect life, and then rose from the dead. And because of all that, we have a place in heaven. But God gave us so much more. All of the miracles, all the interactions that Jesus had with people to show his love and his power to heal us. And John says, even when Jesus came back, he performed so many other signs in the presence of his disciples, and they're not recorded. And so people and situations in your life are going to try and rob you of that peace. But John, in our second lesson from John in 1 John chapter 5, he says, "Who is it that overcomes the world It's only the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God. So whatever troubles that you experience in this world, it cannot rob you of the peace that you have with Jesus. In Him, you have peace with God. Which means you have a peace that goes beyond the things of this world. And it gives you a perspective when bad things happen to you in this world. As a Christian, you expect the world to turn against you. You expect that because you sin, there are consequences to the bad things that happen to you. And because of sin, other people do bad things to you. And so the world turns against you in lots of small ways and sometimes in really big ways. But even though the world is against you, you can still have peace because you are not only a citizen of this world, you are also a citizen of heaven. And as a citizen of heaven, we live in this world looking forward to a place that is much better. We look forward to the peace that we have coming for us in heaven. And until that day, we live content in that peace. And we live to share it with other people who don't know it, who need that peace in their lives. And so when we hear these words from our gospel lesson that Jesus said to the disciples, we know those words are for us too. Jesus said, "Peace be with you." Peace that I have been resurrected. I have accomplished everything I was going to accomplish for you. A peace that lasts. And Jesus goes on, "As the Father sent me, I am sending you. If you forgive anyone their sins are forgiven. And if you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." This ability for us to tell people they are forgiven for their sins is a gift from God, and it's based on something that doesn't change. That's why we begin all of our services confessing our sins. And then I get to reassure you, your sins are forgiven. And I do that based on what God says and what God has accomplished. On Tuesday, when that YouTube shooter finally got to YouTube, it's amazing. She got there, she got to the doorstep, she entered the building, and she saw all the people that she was upset with. And she was so bent on vengeance, she didn't realize that she actually had the chance now to talk to them. She could have just talked to them face to face, heard them out. Maybe they actually could have come to some kind of reconciliation, some kind of peace. But instead, she was so lost on what she thought. She saw what she thought she knew. She ended up shooting three people. And then she took her own life. That immediate stress that she had in her life, that fear that Thomas had in his life, that it couldn't overcome, to know that Jesus had risen does not affect us. Our lives aren't that intense, aren't that chaotic, but we still need peace from God. We have that peace knowing what He's done for us. We hear about that peace in Jesus' words, which is why John finishes this section and he says, "These are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in His name." Take those words to heart. Read them every day and share them with others to live with peace in Jesus.